Hello and welcome to NewsClick. I'm Sumedha. On this episode of the Daily Roundup, we give you a glimpse of some of the most important stories that we report about at NewsClick. Take a look at our top stories of the day. In a symbolic show of strength, Mayawati and Mulayam Singh have shared the dais together after 24 years, after the infamous guest house episode. Both Mayawati and Mulayam Singh Yadav will address a rally in Mainpuri, which they did today, for the SP and BSP Mahagathbandhan. In 1995, the alliance between the Samajwadi Party and the Bahujan Samaj Party broke when the Samajwadi Party workers allegedly attacked the state guest house where the BSP chief was holding a meeting with her supporters. The two parties have, however, now come together once again for the Lok Sabha election of 2019 to defeat the BJP in Uttar Pradesh. We now have with us Prabir to discuss about the significance of what this means coming, 24 years later. So what is the significance of this and how is this going to play out in the election season?
So let's first get one fact straight. It was not an alleged attack.
Yeah.
It was an attack on the BSP. And particularly on its chief and current chief, Mayawati, who was at that time the general secretary of the party. Kashiram was still alive. Now, if we see this issue, it's also the fact that more than 300 people with guns, rods, attacked the BSP meeting, beat up some of the senior leaders present there, and would have also assaulted Mayawati if she had not locked herself in a room. Now, this is not a minor issue. It's an alliance partner who at that time was felt would be pulling out of the alliance and staking claim to becoming the chief minister, which she actually did later. But the point is, irrespective of what the quote-unquote provocation could be, breaking of an alliance, this is barbaric behavior, certainly not befitting of any political party and certainly not of a ruling chief minister and his party, which Mulayam and SP was at the time, of course, in alliance with the BSP. I think the other part of it is the significance of this. Let's not forget, the alliance at that time came after the Babri Masjid was pulled down, post-1992, where both BSP and SP felt the threat of the communalization of UP taking place post Babri Masjid. And that is also the threat today, that BJP is a threat to the communal harmony of UP, complete communalization of UP, in fact, what has happened. And therefore, now both the parties coming together as a consequence of the same threat that brought them together in 1993.
Now we're moving ahead to another big story that we've been covering. The lives of about 20,000 employees and even more at Jet Airways are left in a lurch. They're faced with a delay in payments or the salaries and the prospects of joblessness. Hundreds of airline employees have gathered in Delhi and also in Mumbai to voice their concerns and appeal to the government to intervene for the revival of the company. The staff from across various departments, which includes engineering, maintenance, guest relations, everybody has come together to talk about the Jet Airways. So on Wednesday, the Jet Airways had suspended its operations indefinitely. The airline's revival now depends on the kind of loan that it may end up getting from the SBI, and there is nothing sealed on the fate of that loan as well. The company currently owes rupees 8,000 crores to its lenders, suppliers, pilots and other oil companies as well. The airline only had, 5 jets, and the dozens of others were seized by the creditors in the recent weeks. The lenders were reportedly searching for prospective buyers for the company, and the carrier had also asked ₹400 crore as an emergency fund. After it was denied the fund, the decision to ground the remaining planes was taken. The company got into the financial tailspin in 2007 as well, when it decided to expand its operations and buy Air Sahara for over 1,000 crore rupees and naming it Jet Live. So many believe naming it Jet Light. Many believed at this point in time when the Jet went ahead to acquire Air Sahara that this could potentially lead to a doom for the company because it was paying a very hefty price for the loss-making airline. And Naresh Goyal, who is the head of Jet, who has now stepped down from the board, his style of management was also questioned, and the employees are currently, some of them are also blaming him for the situation that they are in. So as a result of the crisis that Jet is in, many of the other airlines are using this opportunity to fleece other customers by increasing the prices of the tickets, faced with the shortage of the tickets as well. So this is a major consequence which is happening to the lives of consumers and travelers who are left also in a lurch because of the crisis in Jet. Now moving on, at NewsClick we've been covering Gujarat extensively and we're showing you a story of farmers fighting the land acquisition by Reliance Industry. This is a story of their grit and perseverance. About 10,000 acres of land had been acquired by Reliance Industries from 17 villages in Jamnagar in Gujarat between 2006 and 2008. Without the consent of the farmers. However, about 60 farmers in 5 villages have been resisting this and they have fought and held their land inside the cordoned area of the Reliance industry. Take a look at Damayanti Dhar's ground report from Jamnagar in Gujarat.
यहाँ पे आते हुए मैंने देखा कि रिलायंस की पूरी रिफाइनरी और कॉलोनी बनी पड़ी है तो ये काम आप ये यहाँ पे आजू बाजू में आपका गांव है और कितने ऐसे गांव में ये फैला हुआ है
हाँ, मेरे करीब इधर का 16-17 गांव आ जाता है रिलायंस इंडस्ट्रीज के लिए
तो ये कब से शुरू हुआ है
ये रिलायंस इंडस्ट्रीज तो 1992 से हुआ है शुरू और फर्स्ट प्लान था और सेकंड प्लान आया 2006 में 2008 में काम शुरू हो गया था उसका और जो जमीन लिया है इधर का उसमें काम नहीं किया
2008 को मैं आपको पहला नोटिफिकेशन मिला क्या वजह है मतलब आप लोगों ने अपनी जमीन नहीं देने का क्या मतलब रीजन है कारण है दाम नहीं कोट किया सही इसलिए या मतलब आपको जमीन देनी ही नहीं
बिल्कुल दाम बिल्कुल ही कम दिए है इसीलिए ही हमने अपनी जमीन नहीं दी है हमारी जमीन काफ़ी कीमती है आप देखेंगे कि एक शर्ट का जो कपड़ा है वो आपको 20 रुपया मीटर नहीं मिलता है ये जमीन है जो कभी ख़त्म होने वाली नहीं है उसका उन्होंने 20 रुपया हमको रेट कोट किया है
ये मैक्सिमम है इससे भी
ये कम मैक्सिमम इससे कम आपको ज़्यादा नहीं मिल सकता है
मिनिमम क्या कोट हाँ, किया था
मिनिमम 16 रुपया कोट किया
तो
है
खेडूतों को 16 से 20 रुपया
प्रति मीटर जो है उपजाऊ जमीन है जो कि 3 फसल आती है पानी का पूरा व्यवस्था है वैसी जमीन का मैक्सिमम 20 रुपया पर स्क्वायर मीटर गवर्नमेंट ने रेट तय किए है कंपनी और ये दोनों ने मिलकर
और रिलायंस के साथ आप जमीन के मालिक हो और खरीदना रिलायंस को है लेकिन रिलायंस के साथ आपकी डायरेक्ट कभी बात नहीं
होती नहीं सीधा गवर्नमेंट हमको नोटिस देता है गवर्नमेंट ने हमको अवार्ड भेजा है कि आपका जमीन हमने कंपनी के नाम पे एक्वायर कर दिया है उसमें हमको कहाँ भी पूछा नहीं गया है आप देना चाहते हैं नहीं देना चाहते हैं आपका क्या रेट हो सकता है और आसपास के लोगों का क्या रेट हो सकता है इसका मार्केट वैल्यू कितना है कुछ भी नहीं पूछा गया जबकि गवर्नमेंट ने गवर्नमेंट का खुद का और गौचर का जमीन बहुत हाई रेट कोट
किस रेट में बेचा है वेस्टलैंड और
वेस्टलैंड मिनिमम रेट उनका जो है 121 रुपया प्रति स्क्वायर मीटर है और 30% एक्स्ट्रा उसमें कंपनी ने पैसा उसको दिया है और मैक्सिमम रेट जो है 384 रुपया पर स्क्वायर मीटर है उनके ऊपर 30% एक्स्ट्रा पैसा गवर्नमेंट को मिला
गौचर के लिए
हाँ गौचर के लिए और सरकारी लैंड के लिए ये रेट तो आखिर
ऐसा उसी के बाजू में जमीन है खेडूत की तो उसको 16 से 20
हाँ बिल्कुल और वेस्टलैंड होता है उसमें कुछ होता तो है नहीं ठीक है गौचर है तो मान लो कि गाय को खाने के लिए रखा है जमीन ठीक है उपजाऊ जमीन माना जाएगा लेकिन वेस्टलैंड जो है उसके इतने हायर रेट और किसान के बराबर बगल में जो जमीन है उसके 20 रुपया इतना अंतर
जमीन आसमान का फर्क।
हाँ, जमीन आसमान का फर्क। कोई भी किसान अपने
ये सवाल पूछा है अपने सरकारी ऑफिशियल,
तो किसी के पास कोई जवाब हमको मिला नहीं है, ना ऑफिशियली ना रिटर्न में कुछ भी हमको जवाब मिला नहीं है।
आपकी जमीन अभी आपके नाम पे है?
उसके बाद हम लोग पहले से उसमें खेती कर रहे हैं, अभी भी कर रहे हैं। जब 2013 का एक्ट नया आया तो उसमें कुछ सुधार हुआ। सुधार के आधार पे हुआ कि 5 साल तक अगर किसानों की लैंड जमीन खरीद के रखी है, चाहे कंपनी ने पैसा दिया हो या ना दिया हो, और लैंड का जो कब्जा हो वो किसान के पास है, तो वो जमीन वापस की जाएगी और लैंड एक्विजिशन जो है पूरा खत्म कर दिया जाएगा, उसको लैप्स माना जाएगा।
From our national segment, we're now looking into the international segment, where we're focusing today on Argentina and the ongoing protests in the country. And we have with us Prashant. And Prashant, my first question to you is that the country has been witnessing protests in the last few months. But what was the immediate trigger to the protest?
Actually, there have been protests almost every day in Argentina over the last couple of months. And two of the more recent ones are actually a very interesting example of what is happening. So on day before yesterday, that's on the 17th of April, for instance, you had students and teachers protesting. Yeah. And that is because the government enacted a massive cut in education. So the march was called the March in Defense of Science. And this is because science researchers are going to have their budgets massively slashed. And almost 80% of students are going to be affected. And 2,000 applications of students were rejected purely because of this cut. So this is one protest. And on the other hand, you had farmers coming out and actually distributing their produce for free. Yeah. It's called, the protest is called Verdurazo, where they distribute vegetables and grain for free because they're angry at the government for ignoring their plight. So these two protests by different sectors of the economy actually indicate the extent of the crisis at which Argentina is in.
So what has been, you know, the broader context, because this has been happening, like you rightly pointed out, there are multiple segments which are coming together. One day or the other, there are protests. So what is the broader context? What is actually happening in the country?
So first, to give a bit of context, in the past, in the 1990s, Argentina was a playground for the International Monetary Fund. And they brought in all their structural adjustment policies, demanded that the government reduce expenditure. And because of that, the people really suffered. The only people who benefited from these IMF policies were the rich, whose wealth increased, whereas the poor people did not even have food on their tables. So there were massive protests, and finally in 2007, Argentina basically kicked the IMF out. Now, ever since the new president, Mauricio Macri, came to power in 2015, there has again been a revival of these policies. And last year, the IMF and Argentina signed a loan for $57 billion. And as a result of this, the condition has been that the government should reduce the deficit in 2 years. And now this has led to some horrific consequences. For instance, in February, there was a 40% increase in transportation fares, a 32% increase in electricity fares. In March, for instance, there was another 38% increase in drinking water. Again, April, more hikes in drinking water and electricity. So the prices are skyrocketing. And unions across the country have mobilized massively to demand that Macri actually resign. And there are elections coming up in December, so this is one of the contexts. And across Argentina, various sectors have come together because there is no sector which has been left untouched. And a very good example is the G20 protest that happened on November 30th, where from people across the country gathered to protest the G20 policies and Argentina's government as well. And it's also important to remember that Macri is part of Donald Trump's coalition in Latin America. So these are the larger contexts in which this is happening.
So thank you so much for that, Prashant. We at NewsClick, we'll be following this more on the Daily Roundup as well as the story develops. That's all that we have for you today on this episode of the Daily Roundup. To follow these stories and many more, please log on to our website, www.newsclick.in. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook. Thank you for watching.